Welcome back to PlayStation Live from E3. I'm joined once again by Ryan Clement.
Hello.
And we're here with Arthur Parsons from TT Games. And
Hi.
We are going to talk LEGO Marvel Super Heroes 2.
Yeah, we are.
We're back with an even bigger roster of characters.
We are, yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Back with a sequel to 2013's LEGO Marvel Super Heroes. And yeah, we as a team are just super stoked to be back doing this thing, original story, throwing characters together. And having a ball, you know, having fun making video games. That's what it's all about, right?
I have to ask right off the bat, and I think we've even talked about this before, I don't understand how you guys handle the pressure and the expectation of essentially working with, like, the world's most iconic character. It's not like you have, like, this little original hero, and you're like, I sure hope they love him. But it's like, no. It's this huge staple of people that everyone have grown, literally grown up admiring.
Yeah.
How do you guys deal with that? And then how do you, you know, set your own expectations too?
The easiest way to deal with it is we are fans ourselves. So you take what you're given and effectively you just treat it with respect because you've got to handle these things with the care that they need. But if you are a fan, like a true fan, and you're going to be completely authentic to everything about these characters, then that makes authentic, fun video games. You know, yes, I know we parody things, and yes, I know we poke fun at some of the characters, and you know the more serious ones become the butt of some of the jokes, but it's about that level of authenticity. And everyone on the team, from top to bottom, they read comics, they watch movies, they watch TV shows, they watch cartoons to do the research to know exactly who these characters are and what they're about.
What are some of the new characters people can expect for this
There's a whole host because the game's all about time. You know, Kang's out of time, bringing all these universes together. We're going sort of all the way back to Jack Kirby's like Wild West Captain America, which is one of the like craziest, wackiest things I've ever seen. So we're going way back there. We're going all the way into the future with Spider-Man 2099. Yeah, we're going all different tandems, like you know, the Hydra Empire. We're going to, believe it or not, medieval England.
Why not?
Right?
Who knew that there was a whole host of medieval English like superheroes and villains?
So how does the time link all of the characters' stories together? Because they're all from different universes, they're all from different worlds. How are we going to link it all together?
Yeah, so the idea is that Kang has come. Kang's a guy from the future 40th century, and he just wants to rule over everything. But he's really noble about it. It's not like he's coming in with his future tech and he's just like, vaporizing everyone. He comes at, he wants to take on the best of the best at their prime and beat them in a completely fair head-to-head. So he's bringing all these different places together in a city that he wants to rule over called Chronopolis, which is again from the comics. And the cool thing is, when you're bringing all that together and you've got time travel, you can have different versions of those characters all colliding. So, you know, we can have Spider-Man Noir with Spider-Man 2099, with Spider-Gwen, all in one playable group. And they're all like, what are we doing here? You know, who are you? I got bit by a spider. It's like, you know, and then obviously take them on a journey to fight all cool villains and things that are kind of working for Kang. So it's just great to bring that together. You know, we wrote the story with a Marvel comic book writer who wrote two great sort of Kang stories, the Kang Dynasty and also Avengers Forever. So he knows Kang inside out. And it makes for like an epic journey. It's cool.
You're saying that Kang is hosting the world's weirdest family reunion is basically
that's pretty much it. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you've got multiple Captain Americas all stood just like shrugging shoulders, and then you've got other characters pointing and going, Captain. It's just, it's so good. It really is so good. But yeah, in terms of other characters, we're bringing different characters to kind of the forefront. So you play loads of characters during the core story, but you know, we're leading with characters like She-Hulk and Miss Marvel, you know, Black Panther, Captain Marvel, just really going big on different characters. You know, really trying to make sure that it's the whole universe colliding.
Yeah, and you get good representation of all these different famous franchises.
Yeah, absolutely.
Together, yeah.
How has some of the gameplay changed from anything you learned from the first one and how you made it different for the second one?
Well, the first one was, like, really successful. You know, people loved it. I was, like, quite surprised that it was so wide-reaching from, you know, kids to adults and everyone in between. So we looked at that and thought, because it is a true sequel, we have to better everything that we did. So it has to be a bigger open world, you know, a more expansive like storyline, you know, a less linear approach as well. So a bit more branching in there, you know, a better roster, better character abilities, improved combat. Make sure the goons aren't just like coming in and just they're potboilers. They need to be awesome and exciting. So you're mixing up all different like enemy types. So the player's got to think like, how am I going to take this guy down? How am I going to interact with this guy? New mechanics, including time travel and teleportation.
So much going on.
Yeah. Tell me about the team back in the UK are just absolutely smashing this.
They sound like monsters.
Yeah, no, they all just buy into it. You know, we love when we start a journey like this, you know, when we're making a game, they all buy in from the start. They want to deliver the best game they can. So yeah, really good fun.
Can you tell me a little bit about the multiplayer too? Because you know a lot of the, these games are kind of famous for letting people jump in and out. But you decided to make any changes? Or are you sticking with what works?
No. Yeah. So we've got the drop in, drop out co-op for the main story and everything. But we've found a lot of people have been in touch saying, well, yeah, you know, when we're playing a level, my brother will punch me, and then I'll be like, what are you doing punching me? And then we'll spend 10 minutes just brawling in the middle of a level while the boss is in the background going, you know, you're supposed to be fighting me, not each other. And there's that interaction that is really interesting. So we thought, well, we could make something out of that. So we've got this new mode. It's called the Grandmaster mode because it's hosted by the Grandmaster because he's like the master of games. And we have these four-player arenas where it's all on one camera. So you're all pretty much, you know, brought in together. It's kind of inspired a little bit by Power Stone because I'd love that game. And you can take any character you want into the arena. There's a couple of different modes, so there's things to do like capturing infinity gems, you know, collecting points. But ultimately, it's about taking down all the other characters, you know, either together or teaming up. And
so it's like Gladiator, basically.
Yeah,
you just fight to the death.
Absolutely, and it's great because you get to kind of keep the balance because the Grandmaster has the power because he's a super powerful being, so he can kind of make sure that no one's overpowered. Or OP, as my kids would tell me to say. So yeah, they try and give it balance.
You dropped it in there. It was a flawless, great little reference for them.
Yeah,
at home.
But it's fun. It's just a really fun addition to the game. You know, people play our game in the story, and then they spend hours and hours making their own stories in the open world. So then give them something else to experience, like you know this four-player multiplayer. It's just to really deliver a really high-value game. You know, people save up their pocket money a lot of the time. So we want to make sure when they've gone and spent their money, it's like, yeah, that was, you know, I feel like absolutely, you know, I don't know what the word is, satiated. You know, I feel great that I've bought this game.
Perfect word, satiated.
What's some of your favorite characters in and around the office that people really enjoy playing with that are new this time around?
Oh, wow. There are so many cool characters. I like the quirkier character. So I like some of the ones that people don't expect. So there's a lot of those that we've, you know, that we're yet to reveal, but you know, we've got Lockjaw in. Now, when you've got a really bizarre giant dog that can teleport, that's pretty cool.
Cool.
I love Lockjaw. I love the Spider-Man variants, and specifically Spider-Gwen. She's really cool. Love Star-Lord, because I'm a super big Guardians fan anyway. But yeah, it's about that just mixture of characters. So the expected, so it's a character you know, but we're also doing something where we have, it's a bit like baseball trading cards. So rather than the old style grid where you just see the little head when you're in the free play, we have cards now, like trading cards. Ooh. So you can click on them, find out when they first appeared, what their powers are, what makes them tick. You know, we want kids to play this and then go off and read comics and discover what makes these characters great.
So you mentioned Star-Lord, so I have to ask you about a little rumor that I heard. That his Walkman appears and something really special happens when you play.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So every character has like quirky special moves, but with Star-Lord, he can basically just play his awesome mixtape, and then he just kind of is dancing around. Now, when there's like 30 or 40 enemies on the screen and it's all really intense, when you do that, everyone just stops and starts dancing. So it's a cool, quirky thing. But there's a character called Black Knight from medieval England. Well, he has a similar move, but he pulls out a lute and starts playing Greensleeves. So it's all cool, quirky stuff. Our animation team kind of just smash it.
He could also play Scarborough Fair. That would be really great. I would really appreciate that. Maybe just as a bonus, like a DLC.
Nice. I like it. Throw that like in there. It.
Yeah. I only have one more question.
Yeah, no, great. Meredith.
Give me just a little hint, you know, a little inside the studio as to when you guys start, like, oh, we want to put Star-Lord into the game. How does it kind of build up into the Star-Lord that you get? I mean, does it start with, like, the research? And then where does it go from there? Because that's the research is obvious, but then what comes after that?
It is a case of the research, but the research you'd think with someone like Star-Lord is, you know, oh, yeah, well, we'll go and watch the movie, and then we know what we're doing. But it's not. It's about researching every different bit. So, you know, if Star-Lord's in cartoons, watch some cartoons. If Star-Lord's in comics, read those comics. But distill the character down to the bare essentials of what make him cool. And that's across the board with every character. So we take it all the way back to nothing and then go, right, what would make this character cool? And it's, you know, Star-Lord's an easy one. But when you're approaching certain characters, you know, then you have to just dig a little bit deeper and you are going deep into the reference. And then you're thinking, right, button inputs. Because we make sure every button has to do something. You pick that pad up and press a button, you don't want the character to do nothing. They have to do something.
Right.
So then that's how you build up this layering of how you make the character cool. And then we sit down with the animation team and we'll be going, oh, we want them to do this, this, and this. And then the animation team are like, we want Spider-Gwen to get a drum set out from the Mary Janes and do a cool thing where she plays drums. And then you're like, okay, that's cool, we'll do that. So yeah, it's about, you know, just all pulling our creative energies together. It is so much fun working on a character by character basis to bring these out. It's like even Captain America, who we've done previously, this time around he's got loads of new moves. So you can actually hold a button and he'll flip his shield up and then stand on it and he'll slide so you can just like power through enemies, and it's great. I love working on Lego games.
I can tell. Seems like you're a big fan.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
The only other question I have is, where did you get your shirt, and does it come in my size?
Yeah, we didn't even know we were getting these. So we turned up at E3, and I was like, yeah, I go and bought a load of new Marvel shirts. I thought, yeah, I'm all ready. And then it was like, no, here we go. And so we have four. There's a Kang one, a Hulk one, Baby Groot one, and a Spider-Gwen one. So yeah, they're pretty cool.
I'm sure we can dig some out.
We'll find something.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, thank you, Arthur, so much. Okay. Thank you, Ryan, for joining me up here. We'll have a lot more about LEGO Marvel Super Heroes 2 coming very soon. Stick around for a lot more here today on PlayStation Live from E3. PlayStation.